The concept of decolonisation has gained renewed momentum in recent years. While the term itself remains the subject of heated debate, the decolonial movement continues to have a profound impact globally on a variety of cultural institutions. This film explores its role primarily in the context of museums, but also as part of a broader cultural shift that extends through academia, the arts, and society as a whole. For cultural critic Walter Mignolo, decolonisation entailed not just the dismantling of social and geopolitical structures, but also of Eurocentric ways of thinking and seeing. These ways of understanding the world remain deeply embedded in Western cultures, in their colonial histories, and in the spaces and institutions that define how the world is viewed. Museums are places where we struggle over the past and its meanings. These struggles remain inextricably linked to the structures of power and cultural formations of the present. In this film, my intention is to examine how museums have traditionally treated colonized subjects and artifacts, and ask what strategies can be used to contest the forms of historical erasure, objectification, and appropriation that have often been part of the curatorial process. The production of this film was activated by my visit to Cape Town in South Africa as part of an academic exchange between the University of East London and the Cape Peninsula University of Technology. Cape Town has over the last few years been the site of intense political and social struggle. The city's colonial legacy and continuing racialized inequality have been challenged by public campaigns and demonstrations. These began with the Roads Must Fall campaign and continued with the Fees Must Fall protests and campaigns in solidarity with university tertiary staff. While we were there, the university itself was closed down because of the demonstrations, but we still managed to organise an engagement with local student leaders and activists.
Decolonization continues to be an important conversation. So, summarily, decolonization is about questioning the fundamental assumptions of institutions of learning. The idea that learning takes place within a context of a formal schooling is not only false, but it is a historical idea of those who wanted to create a particular kind of a society. You get an institution given power and authority to decide forms of assessments, to actually create a criteria of deciding whether that particular epistemology can be able to fit into. And they call this, by the way, integration and inclusivity. These are very, very, very scary concepts, you know, if you think about it, because inclusivity means including one object into the other. And it assumes that the one that is being included is inferior in nature. And that's a philosophical problem that needs to be addressed in terms of how we think about what institutions are supposed to be, how they're supposed to be relating to other forms of epistemologies.
It was really a very interesting conference in that it brought different people from two different countries to work through and think about the understanding of A, the education system in the country that they were in and the education system at a global level, but also to begin to engage with issues of decoloniality, issues of widening access, issues of understanding student needs and issues of understanding what it is that students required in order for them to be successful.
You need to start from the beginning. Who decides what curriculum is good to teach? Who says that the one you chose is right? So, as I said, it doesn't have a solution for it. But I think that's what we need to find is, where do we start to fix the problem?
Bringing academics and practitioners together, there's a mutual benefit in that. When you're addressing questions like this, which have around access to higher education and what is taught, they have both practical and theoretical components to them, and the most successful projects are going to be those that merge the two.
When the students are organising and protesting, do they use social media?
Yes.
So there would be a very easy way for media to just tap into the social media.
You give the student the number, you exchange the number, and they join the group. You know everything that's going on.
For me, that was one of the first basis I've seen, where first of all students and staff engaged around issues of decolonization. We haven't had that before. We've had students engage with students and staff engage with staff, but we haven't had that dialogue yet, and I think that worked really well.
So public action. We took a long time to think about the title, because the question that came up was, what is decolonizing knowledge production and distribution? And the question that Velani had put to us was, where are student voices in all of this resistance? Students have come up with the critical questions, because let's be honest, it's not the academics who came up with or reignited the question around decolonization. So our question was, how do you put action back into publication? And we said, what we're going to do is go and meet with students and say to them, here's the possibility for a national publication, for you to write about what you want to write. The form is completely up to you. But in addition to that, because we recognize our privilege, we're not going to act as editors, because we're not trying to be academic editors, correcting your work and also giving you suggestion about what you must write. And I'll just read an excerpt. There was once a rat that went to squirrel school. The rat was encouraged to go to squirrel school because the school would grant the rat endless opportunities. The school was on the highest branch of a sturdy oak tree that had taken centuries to grow, and a rat's mere attendance connoted advancement.
I think for me, it was fascinating the kind of tensions and the kind of things that came up, and how difficult it is for people to work with them and to stay in that discomfort.
I kind of feel like people think that there's a level and a space at which you can talk about change, you can theorize change, but you don't have to live it. You don't have to, your life doesn't have to reflect any level of change.
You have people from different countries, you have differently positioned academics in terms of academic hierarchies, you've got academics and practitioners, you've got a lot of structures and systems that could potentially be silencing and reenacting existing hierarchies and hegemonic narratives, and I think we made a step towards disrupting those. And what I found really encouraging, that it is possible that you can have lecturers and deans in a room and fight it out, and it's not easy, but it's possible.
Inclusivity offends me, because my experience is of inclusivity, because it's a term that's been banding around, but essentially what you're saying is there's a container that accommodates white supremacist patriarchy, and you want to include the other in this container, whereas to me decolonization says there's a colonial container. And how do we deconstruct that?
Yeah.
And that's where the difference is for me. Yeah. So I reject terms like inclusivity, and I reject terms like diversity when it comes to certain aspects, particularly because those are terms that have been co-opted and used against the very people that they seek or they were supposed to actually address.
After returning from Cape Town, I continued my doctoral research at the University of East London. The university has a 72% BAME student body, is located in a borough that is 71% BAME, and in a city that has a 41% BAME population overall. In this context, it seemed important to understand how decolonial debates might inform partnerships and engagement strategies between the university and other social institutions. Museums often serve to reproduce Eurocentric structures of knowledge. However, decolonial discourses have also sometimes infiltrated these institutions to challenge those systems of representation. The Museum of London's Docklands Sugar and Slavery exhibition has been in existence for 10 years and serves as an interesting case study for how museums can explore the historical legacy of British imperialism and the racism that undergirded it. New members of the museum's curatorial team were actively pursuing decolonial strategies, exhibitions and events. These included an event that celebrated the 10th anniversary of the exhibition's opening.
I think it's extremely important in the teaching of enslavement that we should always have resistance top, front and centre of what we do.
A partnership between the Museum of London Docklands and the University of East London potentially offered a route whereby decolonial processes could be consolidated in both a curatorial and pedagogic context. To this end, I proposed using film to capture some of the exhibition's curatorial strategies as part of a broader engagement between the university and the museum.
Because civilization in itself started in Africa, and all these artifacts that you see here were even made before the British or the Europeans went to Africa.
The gallery opened in 2007 at the height of the 200-year commemorations of the Abolition of the Slave Trade Act, which went through Parliament in 1807. Having the London Sugar and Slavery exhibition at the Museum of London Docklands was of relevance because of the actual history of the Docklands area, and the building that the display sits in was actually a warehouse that was opened in 1802 to hold rum and sugar. So it has a direct connection to the trade in enslaved Africans. So boats would leave here from the West India dock. They would then land in Africa, where they would load enslaved Africans into the ships. They would then go to the Caribbean, where they would trade these enslaved Africans for rum and sugar, which would then come back and be deposited in this warehouse, which is the number one warehouse on West India Quay.
As London's population is so diverse, it's important that people of African and Caribbean descent know the history of how this country and this city has maybe engaged with their countries of origin and people like them over the past couple of hundred years, and that they come here to the museum knowing that they've contributed to the wealth of this city. The gallery was put together in collaboration with an advisory group, and that advisory group was made up of sort of leaders from the community. Also, academics had a major consultative role in the putting together of the exhibition, and also we involved some artists, directors, filmmakers, lots of different types of creative people as well. There are quite a lot of creative responses in the gallery space, and I think that's an important way of demonstrating that the information in the gallery can be displayed in quite a lot of different ways. So it's not just text panels, we also use quite a lot of video, and there's also a lot of commissioned artwork and some commissioned poetry, and also poetry responses by young people who were engaged with during the putting together of the gallery. I think the display itself is obviously quite provocative and quite emotive. Parts of the exhibition are quite sad, and it's important that people have the opportunity to respond to that. I think a lot of people also feel quite empowered by the ability to leave a comment, and they're able to share with others how viewing the display has affected them. It also allows us to develop the gallery space. So there are things that were added to the gallery over the years because we had a lot of feedback that those sorts of things should be in there. Resistance was something that was really important to the advisory group, because a lot of the time the visitors that we have to the gallery are of African or Caribbean descent, and they wanted to make sure that those visitors weren't walking into a space where they were treated as if they didn't stand up for their rights and stand up for themselves, as if they were passive throughout the whole process of enslavement, which we know was not true. There are a number of large-scale slave revolts in the British Caribbean. There was one in the midst of the debates about emancipation, how it would be achieved, and that actually sped up the process. I think the gallery makes a special point of stressing that Black history does not start with slavery and the history of enslavement. So we do feature objects from West Africa, such as the Benin bronzes, which are on loan from the British Museum, to emphasise the sort of civilisation of these areas, which is often downplayed and outright denied in a lot of tracts that were written by European travellers at this time, to justify slavery and to sort of portray it as a great civilising mission that was helping African people to advance forwards. Also in the gallery, the curatorial team sought to emphasise that there was a black presence in Britain aside from slavery and prior to slavery. So there's attention given to certain individuals whose presence in Britain predates the period of enslavement, or who were in Britain not because they were enslaved people. London's got a very diverse population, and it's important that these audiences are catered for in museums. BME audiences are amongst the groups who visit museums less. So it's important that we do things to encourage them to engage with our museum spaces, and galleries that engage with their histories are one way of doing this.
Throughout the period of slavery, about 3,000 ships that moved from here to the coast of Africa.
Also important are museums having more diverse bodies of staff.
I am interested in the ways in which the plantation was managed, but I'm also looking for traces of the enslaved. But the documents that I'm presented with are very statistical. They're lists, they're slave registers. You just get people's names sometimes, they're fleeting. Every once in a while you get a story. One of those examples does come from this estate. Her name was Beto Douglas.
So a lot of museums are very much majority white organisations. Access to museum careers is quite difficult if you're not from a certain type of background, because you're expected to have done a lot of volunteering. Free sort of internships where you give up your time without pay. I think museums have found it quite hard to sort of decolonise their institutions and to engage more broadly with people from diverse backgrounds. I think one of the problems with that is the staff of the museum. So if the staff is not diverse and it doesn't reflect London's population, when they seek to engage with people who aren't like them and who don't think like them, who don't see the world like them, who aren't interested necessarily in the same types of music or art or theatre or film as them, they then find it quite difficult to get into these people's heads and to create things that these people will enjoy. So in May of 2018, we had a 10-year commemoration celebration for the London Sugar and Slavery Gallery. But we didn't just want the event to be a celebration of the gallery, we wanted it to be an opportunity for people to reflect and also respond to the gallery. So we had quite a lot of time for the audience to reflect on what they liked about the gallery, had it lived up to expectation, but also to respond. So how could the gallery do things better? How could it better engage with artists? How could it better engage with communities? How could it better engage with young people and involve more young people in the programming?
Some work that you was ashamed to do, we came here and get it done. And now you're telling me and my children, we can't be British citizens.
While I was exploring curatorial strategies at the Museum of London, other participants from the Wish Exchange were examining critical debates around decolonisation in an academic setting. Cindy Gordon organised a conference at Sussex University entitled Decolonial Transformations, and some of the academics from South Africa travelled to the UK to participate.
The first guideline that I'll talk about is the issue of open methodology, which has allowed for creativity. It's given room for freedom to disrupt certain structures.
We had a reading groups and we had seminars where lecturers could come together and talk about how it is and what it is that you were teaching and the ways in which you could decolonize and rethink the ways in which we're engaging with our students.
What gives you membership into who you are?
As a student, as a lecturer, as a head of department, as a professor, as whatever space or role you hold within this university.
What defines that membership? Who's included and who's excluded?
So I'm going just to give you a brief introduction to our project that brought us here. So as Asanda mentioned, we met some of the organizers and Orson, Cindy, last year in October in Cape Town for a workshop that we organized that was funded by the British Council. And it brought together 36 early career researchers to talk about issues such as diversity, decolonization, student needs, from both a British and a South African perspective. And These are some of the pictures. This was a student workshop we had before the three-day main workshop started.
The conference was an opportunity to explore some difficult questions around how these debates operate within universities and how radical pedagogic practices might challenge Eurocentric perspectives.
Imagine a population, student population, all white. So imagine me, in that context, teaching about social justice, the history of slavery, from different perspectives. Students get into that module thinking that I will be talking about conquest, power, you know. The title is deceiving, I say. It's called, one of the modules called Ship, Slaves, France and Britain in the Atlantic World, which means that they actually confront, I'm confronting two histories. I'm French, so France and Britain fighting for power in the Atlantic world. So when students come to me, they expect me to talk about this European perspective. So how do you try and ship things and see them see things differently? Instead of having all these big names that you know, people you know on telly, writing about colonial history and all that, I've been trying to work, I've been including people like T.R.R. James, Eric Williams, Joseph Inikori, because from our perspective, and quite often historians use reading lists which are made mainly of historians. So I started that way, including women as well, you know, Renee Shepherd and many others, Martha Jones, Anna Lucia Araujo, who are working on these things. So you start very slowly by doing things very slowly.
Then we aren't always against them. We are in them.
Yeah.
And unless we recognize where we're in them, we're not going to be able to do much.
As anthropologists, which is very much inscribed into the history of our discipline, we are always complicit in, and we are culpable for it. But the discussion about decolonizing anthropology is only taking place in the margins.
Another participant of the Wish Exchange organised an event at the Pitt Rivers Museum in Oxford through his participatory media company InsightShare. It entailed working in partnership with a group of Maasai activists and the museum directors to examine the museum's catalogue of Maasai artefacts.
Yeah, that's it. It's another polis. So it came to the museum in 1904. So collected sometime
before.
I was really shocked. Because there are some things that I never imagined of getting them in such a far place like this one. Because there are some sacred things that cannot even be lent to somebody. Even if it is a close person to you, you will never use them. So for sure, that is one of the big questions that we were asking the curators. Yes, how all these things end up being on their hands or being end up coming to the museum. We just wanted to follow their history and know if it is possible for us to trace them. We have gone through about 40 to 45 items and very few of them have the right description. There are some items that their description of where they were gotten from or collected from was a bit awkward. because we have one of the items that is worn on the face by warriors, made of ostrich feathers, and it is supposed to be worn only on a special occasion.
For ceremonial location.
It is only for ceremonial location.
So to me that slightly suggests that there was a fight and then this was taken from somebody's home.
But their description was that it was collected during the fight. So our question was that, how? Then, after that, we came and sat down and think, how comes this thing was said like this? And we said, maybe during that time, yes, there was a ceremony, but there are still people who were taken on an ambush and they were killed, and that thing was collected. Most of them have a big question mark on how they were collected. Maasai culture is a living culture. And when a person dies, the items are still alive. It is pain, for real it is pain, to find some of these things in this place. Instead of us taking back the item back to the community, they prefer us to make a bond so that they can also use it as a symbol of the Maasai community being in the museum. But for us, our big thought was that if it was possible, we can take the most sensitive things. At least we can make something, a big agreement between the two sides, so that even our community, as the owners of this thing, these items, can benefit from them.
I think around the same time as the 1890s and beginning of the 1900s, some of the collecting happened of some of the sacred objects, and so, yeah, knowing that those were difficult, yeah, so difficult moments for the Maasai dealing with land grabs and drought. So I think that's important.
And that was before or after the mission?
No, this is so the missions were from the 17th century, but this is late 19th, beginning of 20th century.
1960 to about 1980s, it was peaceful, it was kind of calm. Mm. There was no any exchanges, problematic exchanges between neighbors and communities and the government. It was relatively peaceful until the 1980s.
Shall we decide what we're going to do this morning together? I think we're going to start with Paola's drawing. Yeah. So let's move over here. I'm going to hand over in a sec. I'll just get us started. So if we come all over here and we're going to look at Paola's drawing, come everybody up here, closer to the drawing. So I've heard there's a few things we want to achieve today before lunchtime, which is at 12 o'clock. So we were going to start not looking, Paola doesn't like it, it's not Paola's drawing, it's our drawing with Paola. We're going to look at our drawing with Paola.
Not my drawing, it's ours, because I've captured your voices here as much as I could. And from my experience, if you decide to have it today, during the event, it will be on the wall, but it will install a few conversations around certain issues. So this is our opportunity to send some messages that you perhaps are not will decide not to say it out loud, you're on your own,
But the big picture can say those, no? Can send those messages. So anything at all that you wish to say, now is the time, and I can do my best to depict it.
Does it show what you feel we decided and agreed yesterday?
I think one of them, maybe from me, what is missing is a partnership and the bigger picture of decolonization of the Maasai collection in terms of artifacts and
the
returns. Because it's also partly like one of the way forward. Getting the museums and getting the partnership and
the museum.
Yes, it's something
just happened with the Pitt Rivers.
Yeah, and we developed the whole plan, so we're in a partnership. Yes. It's true, it didn't happen here, but it happened before.
We haven't found a put up like a pilot sort of a program to see whether we can, how far we can go with the decolonization.
I would start with the museum encounter. Then show how we've been documenting that encounter last week on film, and that the next stage is for the Maasai to go and show the film to their traditional leaders and explain everything that's happened, and then to take that wider to the whole community through touring the film and using video to get their input on the vision. So all of that, I see it all spreading here, like down here, the starting with the museum
here,
and then...
Most important thing is this object, as I said, some of them are not only important for our culture, but also some of them are very sacred.
Indigenous leaders from different countries came to the museum, but Samuel was the one who was most sort of immediately asking me, okay, I'm really concerned about this. This is not new. I mean, there's many indigenous people who react to collections being in museums in similar ways. So we've had similar sort of reactions and projects also with indigenous people from other places in the world. But Samuel was very sort of clear in sort of saying, I'm really concerned about the way that, you know, labels are written here. And so he then, when he went back to Tanzania, wrote a message with four main concerns. Some of the concerns really were about the fact that it was missionaries who then sort of sold them to the museum, that we had purchased them from missionaries. How would some of these things ever have been taken? And that panned out much more in detail with the visit that has happened in the last 2 weeks. But also that the information that accompanies the objects is not accurate. Often the labels were wrong, items weren't identified as they should be, but also that, you know, the people who made them, exactly who collected them, was completely unclear from what was presented in the collections. And then also that certain objects were very sacred and shouldn't be handled by just about anybody. We as museums are confronted with some of the sort of thinking around how complicit are we in how far does a sort of sense of moral justice needs to, you know, sort of enter into museum practice around how do we make amends with some of these collections, having some of these collections, and redress some of the relationships under which they were collected.
My colleagues will be a little bit talking about the connection, the sacredness. But one thing I wanted to make clear is our culture is so resilient that even when you saw an object like this, which is over 100 years, it is as new as we are.
We have traveled many years in the history of our lives, and we have gone through many difficult times. And despite all that, our culture has remained very resilient. As we have come in contact with other cultures, as globalization has taken hold of everybody, knocking on everybody's door, as digital technology has found its way into our culture, we have seen some changes taking place in our culture. And some of the changes are not good. Some are good. We decided consciously to conceive a strategy to revitalize our culture, to really enable the Maasai to embrace more their own culture and to come together to engage in discussions, dialogue around the currently prevailing social change process in order to determine which changes to embrace and which ones to decline in order to ensure our survival, not only culturally, but as a people. For the Maasai, culture is everything. Our culture is intertwined with our livelihood system. Our culture is not only a social reality. It encompasses the entire way of life. The land, the economy, the personal economy, the environment, everything. Social relations, everything. So our living culture strategy is really about strengthening our community to be more resilient in the face of globalization, in the face of increasing and fast social change, as well as in the face of climate change, which is affecting everybody in our planet. And we hope by doing so, we will further enhance the resilience of our culture, as well as become a source of hope for other cultures in the world, including the rich culture in the other countries. So we are here to share with you our new vision, our new journey towards really revamping, revitalizing our culture to make it more resilient and to enable our people to unite around their cultural values in order to take care of their own environment